But we'll get started anyway. I'm going to bring on the first interviewer. Please welcome Mr. Ben Dave. Please welcome Dave Owen.
Thanks, Bob. We've got two new guests to start the day. They're completely new to the world of Doctor Who events. This is the first time either of them has appeared to answer questions, so please be attentive and gentle, as I know you will be. Firstly, we have somebody who appeared in Doctor Who twice in the 1980s, first in Earthshock as Berger, and secondly as Elizabeth in Battlefield. Please welcome June Bland. And secondly, you may think that fighting the Daleks in widescreen colour next to Bernard Cribbins with someone called Tyler is a 21st century innovation, but it's not. They were doing it back in the 60s. Please welcome the Doctor's niece from Daleks Invasion Earth 2150, Jill Curzon. Welcome, both of you. This is your first time at this sort of thing. What were your, both of you, what were your preconceptions? What were you expecting at a Doctor Who convention?
Oh, probably a fuller house. But they've told me it's going to get fuller later, so I might stick around to watch that. I don't know, this is, it's my first time. I've never done it before. And I'm sure it's going to be very exciting once I get this interview over. Because I like to know my lines. So bear with me. But I think it's tremendously exciting because, what was the question? Oh, I think you asked what was I going to expect. Yes, yeah, well, I don't know quite what to expect, so I'm going to hand over to Jill.
As you said, we're both first-timers. We're not exactly youngsters, but we're first-timers in this. And it's all very exciting. I've never seen so much excitement and interest in
the
Daleks.
The preparation, too, yeah. Is wonderful. And to
have such a great team of people, it's most impressive. Great fun.
Where have you come from to be here today?
Well, we live in Spain.
Okay.
So we flew yesterday.
That's good going.
And I live in Molesey, and I drove yesterday.
Okay. Not so exotic. I'm going to have to start asking you one of you questions next. I feel great kinship with Libby Purvis on Midweek on Radio 4, who has 8 people to interview who have never worked together and has to bring them together, so we'll try and do that. So, randomly, June, I'll start with you first. How did you get into acting? How long have you been doing it for?
A very long time. I started when I was 4, and when I was 16 I went into a very tatty panto tour, which was wonderful really, and that's where I went blonde and have stayed blonde ever since. Then I went into what was so wonderful in those days, weekly rep, where you were able to do a different play every week. It sounds impossible, doesn't it, but you do it. And I did about 7 years in all at Derby, Northampton. And that was really the most wonderful, I think, grounding for any actress. And then I got married and had 3 children, but I still kept doing all of that. Then we moved to Thames Ditton, and my husband is Bill Sellers. He actually produced the first Doctor Who with William Hartnell, which is quite interesting. And then I started doing some telly, all those lovely Dick Haynes shows, Steptoe and Son, all the odd bits, until I finally managed to get The Newcomers, which was 4 years. You're probably all too young to remember that, are you?
I think we are. What was it about?
4 years, twice a week, with Wendy Richard playing my daughter, which, no, she's not older than me. I'm afraid. And then Doctor Who at 1982, I think. Oh, I think before that, I think I did a Chichester season with, I'm told to say, Ingrid Bergman, because that was really a tremendous experience. Then I did Earthshock with Peter Davison, 1982, and then lots of West End musicals in between. 1989, I did Battlefield. And so it goes on. So I think you've got to say something now.
Well, yes. What were you doing at the same time, Angel?
Well, we started the same way. In those days, it was wonderful. I have to say, I agree with you, with the repertory system. And I started as an ASM, which is assistant stage manager, where you really stand in the wings and you cue people on and you're a dog's body and you yes. buy bits of furniture and you run around with your car and, you know, you do every job.
ASM
and then you and
cast,
you have a very, yes, and you have a small part,
yes.
maybe,
yes.
in which you play that evening. But during the day, there's a rehearsal for the next play, for the next week. So you're rehearsing one and performing another, and it's and sometimes you have wigs to change and then plus you're cueing the other actors. It's tremendous grooming, because you have to learn every possibility that happens in the theatre, and I loved it. And then went on tour, and then I did I got a big break, really, because in the BBC, they have what they call in-house short movies for the staff who want to become from floor managers to assistant directors to directors. And I was lucky enough to, there was a program called Dixon of Dot Green, which was a police thing before Z cars and before all these modern police series. And maybe you probably haven't heard of that either. But I did a 20-minute piece with him. The actors didn't get paid, and it was just a 20-minute two-parter. And it was shown to all the directors and everybody in the BBC. And one of them was David Croft, who picked me for the part in Hugh and I. So that was really my start. And then the following year, I got the Walt Disney lead, which was very, very exciting. And I met Walt. And
which lead was that?
It was Dr. Sin, S-Y-N. And Elias the Scarecrow. It's about a smuggling story in the Cinque Ports in Romney Marsh. Beautiful costume drama,
yes.
And I was the Disney lady with the ringlets, you know, the ingenue. Yeah, it was great.
I've never been a Disney lady with ringlets. I'd like to be.
Well, maybe that's the only thing you haven't
done. We've had Ingmar Bergman and Walt Disney. I mean, I'm not sure how we can follow this. When did you come to Doctor Who, Jill? What led to you getting the part of Louise in Daleks Invasion Earth?
Well, I was asked to meet Gordon Fleming to audition for the second movie, which with Peter Cushing and Bernie Cribbins. And I did a small read-through with him, and he gave me the part. And we had Roberta Tovey, of course, from the first movie, who was in played the granddaughter. And I played the niece, Louise. And we had great fun. Bernie Cribbins was very interesting to work with.
Yes, he
we
was.
Were talking.
With Bernie.
Yeah.
Yes.
And he used to come to work on bicycle at Shepperton Studios, and then he'd, everyone wondered why he wanted to ride a bike, but he had his fishing gear. So every lunchtime he would go down, we would all go to the commissary and eat lunch, and he would go fishing in the river, which was just round beside Shepperton Studios. And very interesting, in the next studio we had Casino Royale. It was the first Casino Royale with David Niven. And Ursula Andress was in that one. And I remember she came to lunch and we met all the girls. I was the only girl in Studio A in the Dalek movie, only young lady. And the next studio, there were so many beautiful girls,
yes.
And they all came to lunch, but I think Bernie Cribbins missed out going fishing.
I'm not sure whether Bernie would mind very much.
No, maybe not.
And I don't think he's riding his bike anymore.
What was his profile like? Because I think it was a few years after he'd had his big hit single, Right Said Fred. So was he still really well known for that kind of thing, or just a jobbing actor?
That's hard to really say.
Bernie's always been a very good jobbing actor.
Yeah.
Yes.
He's quite good at Shakespeare too.
Yes, and extremely versatile. I did Anything Goes with him, the musical.
Mm.
And I mean, he's musical as well.
Yeah.
You know, he can do it
he's
all.
He's very talented.
Whatever happened to him?
Whatever happened to him?
I'm being sarcastic.
Oh, yes.
He's in Doctor Who
horrid,
again.
Yes. Horrid person.
Yeah.
It's a good observation, Jill, about the Dalek film, you being one of very few adult female leads in that. Women in general weren't presented brilliantly in the film.
Yeah.
All the resistance rebels were men in their donkey jackets and their tweed jackets, and the robo men were all robo men, there were no robo women.
Well,
and there were just a couple of gypsy women in the woods who...
Yeah, that's right, in my movie.
Yeah, that's right.
But the movie before, of course, you had the Fowls.
That's right.
And so there were some ladies in that, quite good looking ladies, maybe.
Very glamorous.
Yes.
What did you guess about Louise's character? Because it's very hard to work out who she is and what she does when she's not travelling in the police box.
Well, she was Peter Cushing's niece. I mean, they didn't give a biography of what she did or who she was, but I think she was a fairly ordinary sort of well-brought-up girl, you know.
She's very well-brought-up.
She was obviously very interested in what her uncle did, and she had the special costume made, so she was obviously working with him quite a bit. No, they made the Sherlock Holmes with the lovely sleeves and the
wonderful.
And I had these fantastic boots with two zips up. I kept for years. And then all the leather went hard and I decided it was time to throw them out.
Well, you obviously came out much more glamorous than I. I mean, as Berger, I wonder why. As Berger, I was thrown into, and so was Bill Reed, a pair of very heavy grey army boots. And these sort of rather stern-looking trousers and grey leather.
The whole thing was very grey, wasn't it? Yes.
Yes. Yes, it was. Yes, but great fun. Great fun. She was lovely to work with. Lovely. Yes.
What was did you get any feeling for the character of Berger herself? Because I know you had a look at the story during the week.
I had to get the videos out and remind myself this week of what I'd done. I was quite severe, really, wasn't I?
The calm of the storm, I'd like to think.
I think she was there to hold the whole thing together. You know, everybody kind of pivoted round me, I think. Did that come over? Because that's what I meant to do.
Yeah, absolutely. You've got Bell Reed on one side being very imperious and giving orders, and then you've got Alex Sabin on the other side as the wronged underling who's out for revenge, and it really does need an anchor in the middle to pivot
it's
off.
It's very difficult working those knobs as well. I don't think we ever got into warp drive.
Maybe you didn't have a technical lesson first.
Or no technical lessons. No, just the script and get on with it.
You had to learn it fast.
Yes. Yes, and those scenes with Beryl Reed, we actually did. They were lifted out of sync. We actually did all of those scenes over 2 days just to get them out of the way for Beryl. Sorry, because she was doing something else. No other reason. It wasn't that she hated it or anything like that. So that was actually quite difficult, doing those scenes, because you do it and then you do the next one, and there was no continuity at all. And then when you watch it, you think, yes, that's where that scene came in. So I had to do that this week.
It was one of the most intensive Doctor Who's that had been made until that time. I think there were 300 separate scenes, which was more akin to a feature film than a TV drama. Did you feel that on set, that you were up against it to try and get it done in time?
Yes, I think so. I mean, the Cybermen were quite scary, really, because they're so well done. All those lovely 6'6" actors inside, and you can't see them, you know, all in heavy boots. And the explosions actually do come out of here. So it's really quite scary once you get involved in the atmosphere. Did you find that?
Yes,
getting involved in the...
You know, it's very strange because we never
I never saw any of the Dalek operators. So it was all a mystery. You know, that you knew there was someone in there. But it was so mysterious. And of course, then the terrible time in the middle of ours, one of the takes, when the Dalek fell down the ramp and caught fire. And that was for real. And they had to really get their guy out really quickly. That's the first time I saw a Dalek operator, and he was burnt. Yeah, but he was okay, thank goodness.
It's a tough way to actually have to see a Dalek operator, isn't it?
And then there was, years later, my husband and I went up to North Wales to a tiny little museum that apparently is not there anymore. It's
Is that Slangorton?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. And one of the guys greeted me there, and a big tall chap, and he said, I was on the set of your movie, except when I was 2 years old, because my dad was a Dalek operator. That's sweet.
Yes.
He was so nice. You know, it was fantastic, really.
In some ways, it's quite good, I think, because they remain alien then, and that's better for us, I think, rather than know the person inside. Do you reckon?
Oh, yes, I see what you mean.
Yes.
Sure.
I think that's very good.
Get to meet them afterwards.
Yes,
you know,
there should
which
be
is lovely.
That feeling of fear.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Mm. Certainly.
Yes.
Of course, if you were doing it now, you'd probably just be acting to a green screen or a man holding a sign, and they'd put all the monsters on afterwards. So,
it's so technical now. There's lovely, lovely old ones. Were absolutely charming, really, weren't they? Mm. Do you prefer the old ones to the new ones? I'm asking you questions now. Yeah.
I think that was non-committal.
Well, okay.
Who's asking?
All right.
What was your director on Earth Shock like, Peter Grimwade? Some performers have said he was very committed to the end product, possibly less so than the well-being or happiness of his cast. Did you find him an intense
where
director?
Where did you hear that from?
That would be telling tales.
I wasn't going to mention that.
Everyone else has.
Okay. Yes. He was very young, inexperienced. We all are. To begin with, you have to learn somewhere, but with experienced actresses like Beryl, for instance, it was not easy. But bless him, I think the end result was okay, and that's really what matters, because older actors and actresses can usually handle younger directors quite well, really. So, who told you that?
Everyone. If look at the DVD of Earthshot. And there's a documentary at the end, and I was, Peter Grimwade.
Oh, really? Yes. Whatever happened to Peter Grimwade?
He died quite young, unfortunately. I think he died before he was 50, and he carried on directing Doctor Who, and then he wrote a few as well, and that was the last involvement of it, I know. But he didn't live very long, unfortunately.
Oh, okay.
Moving on. What have you done, Jill, since Dalek's invasion Earth? I read you relocated to the United States for quite some time.
Well, I did a lot in England before that.
Okay, tell us about that.
I did a lot of drama, a lot of comedy, Morecambe and Wise, and, nearly all the Dick Emery and Roy Hart and all those people. And then I did many drama plays, which I love, with Milo O'Shea and people like lovely Irish actor. And... then, of course, I did The Saint with Roger Moore, which was sort of a precursor to the Bond films. We're just looking at some old ones.
Was Robert Brennan in those?
No,
we're just chatting amongst ourselves.
We have to compare notes. No, it was a super experience, though. I loved that. Mm. Very nice. We had the set, which was made out of styrofoam, you know, like a styrofoam rock, and I had to fall over a cliff. And this thing was so light, you know, you had to...
almost came with you.
Yeah, so you had to really fake the fact that it was a rock.
Yes.
And I had to hang there, and actually I was kneeling. And then you have to make your arms look like they're hanging, which isn't very easy, because you're sort of like that, and then... You know, to try and, you have to actually pull away. And so it's had a sort of reverse effect.
Quite a lot.
And then Roger Moore, of course, had to help me out.
Of course.
I think I had some very tight
pants. Did you get paid as well?
I get paid as well.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Oh, I did, yes, quite a lot of interesting things. And then I went to the States and I was there, did a couple of movies in Hollywood. Okay. One with Cliff Robertson and Dina Muriel, who was his wife. That was a very good Sunshine Patriot, it was called. It was a thriller. Very, very nice.
Having worked in lots of different media, stage, television, film, what's your favourite? Do you have a favourite?
I think I have to say film.
Why is that?
To me. I just enjoy the way of working. Having said that, I love to be on stage. I love to be with people. And I enjoy very much live comedy shows for television because there you have an audience, and I love having an audience. It's a nice feeling. Yeah, and the feeling that, you know, here we go, and if they don't like it, you know.
That's
so,
right.
And et cetera, and hear people laugh genuinely. Today everything's sort of canned laughter, and, you know. But filming is more, it's more my way I enjoy it very much. I love it.
About you, Jean, which do you prefer?
Me?
Yep.
I actually prefer the theatre because I do love that live contact. Mm. I love working my audience. But you require a lot of stamina for that. I mean, I was 3 years in Me and My Girl, a year in Anything Goes, The Boyfriend, a year. And you're going out every night and you have to give it your all every night, which is wonderful because you do actually receive from your audience as well. But I couldn't do it now. I do love the theatre, but you do need that stamina for going out every night, giving your performance. And nothing else probably happening in your life during the day, you know, so that you can lie in and stuff. No, that's not canned laughter, is it?
No, don't think so.
Okay.
Yes,
I do love television, yes, but I think I find it a bit nerve-wracking, really. Well, years and years ago, I mean, when we did The Newcomers, that was live, and it came from Lime Grove.
Oh, yeah.
And we were all very, very tense, and I don't know if you would remember, but there used to be a button, the AFM had a button, so that if you dried, the assistant floor manager, the AFM had a button, and if you dried, they pressed that, gave you your prompt, and that actually cut the sound off from everybody's television sets. They gave you your prompt, and then you were back on. And that was a bit nerve-wracking. But now with recording, it's a bit easier, a little bit easier, isn't it? Yes, I mean, you can actually swear in front of the camera and get away with it, you know, because they're going
to... Or she says it's bleep.
Yes.
Do we have time for any audience questions? I wonder, do we even have a microphone out there? I can see somebody getting up to get one. It's there. Do people come up and ask questions? Anybody wants to ask any questions of our guests? Just make your way to the front.
Look at them rushing. They're all rushing.
Don't be intimidated. No one will be looking at you.
We must have covered everything.
We haven't covered your second Doctor Who much, actually, June.
Battlefield.
How did that one come about?
That's right. It's difficult doing that because, of course, it's still me, but very, very different kind of character. We did, all my bits were done on location.
Okay.
In Rutland, as Nick Courtney will probably tell you, because I did it with Nick. And we went to this wonderful, wonderful hotel in Rutland for a week or so, had a lovely time. But I didn't get to meet, you see, you don't, with television, you very often don't get to meet people who are in it. With filming, absolutely, yes. And that's a shame. But what do you want me to say about Battlefield?
I don't know, do you remember?
I felt, you know, this bit, oh, I can
see. It was so corny, really, wasn't it?
Is there a technique to blind acting that you get taught in week three of drama school? Is there a technique to blind acting?
Well, it wasn't technique. No, I had to wear opaque contact lenses. And I don't wear contact lenses. So they were made up for me by Clulos, very, very good people. And I had to start rehearsing at home with the contact lenses every day, sitting over the coffee table with these opaque lenses. And of course, by the time I got one in, I couldn't see to get the other in. All over the place. Anyway, I did it. So by the time we got to the studio day, I couldn't see a thing. Not a thing. I could only see blotches.
You didn't have to
act
at all.
I didn't have to.
Method.
No. But the eyes through the day dried up. You know, there was an optician there, and I had to keep blinking. I don't know what people thought with me blinking all the time. So by the time I got to the end of the day, the eyes were very, very sore. So they took them away and cleaned them for the following week. And of course, by cleaning, they'd taken some of the opaqueness. Is it a word?
Opaqueness? Opacity, perhaps?
Opacity?
If Colin Baker was here, he could tell us that.
Off it, so I was able just to see. Then I was doing blind acting, because I could see just a little more clearly through it. But that was not easy. No, I felt I should have had danger money.
No, it's just
one of
those. Uh-huh. You think she's going to be a much more significant character in the piece than she turns out to be. It's a shame.
I was disappointed when I saw the amount of lines. Mm. Yes. No, I thought she was going to play a very big part in this, but I think she was only there to show that Jean Marsh, who played Morgaine, could do good things as well. I think that's why I was there.
I think you managed to elevate it beyond the lines in the script. I was surprised that she's there in a few scenes.
Yes, they just bundled us into the back of a truck, and
that's right.
That was it.
I think we're getting near the end of our time here. Can I ask a couple of last questions to both of you? Starting with Jill, how would you like to be remembered? What footprint would you like to leave behind you?
Terribly difficult question. Yes. I don't even know how to answer it, really.
Do you mean a particular...
Do you mean a part or a performance
or a
character?
You could interpret it like that. Yes. If you had to be remembered for one piece of work, what would it be?
Not the Disney, because that was really... the Daleks really is lovely.
Correct answer.
Correct answer? Did I get a correct answer?
Me too.
Well done. Actors and diplomats both. Thank you very much indeed for sharing your memories with us. I believe you're going to be around later today signing autographs immediately and also having photos taken. If you've been too shy to come up to the microphone, I'm sure... Jill and June will quickly talk to you and answer any immediate questions. In the meantime, thank you very much indeed, June Bland and Jill Curzon.